kingdom, and these things will be provided for you. Don't be afraid, little flock, because your Father delights to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Make money bags for yourself that won't grow old, an inexhaustible treasure in heaven where no thief comes and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Everybody say verse 34 with me. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, this morning we ask you to bless the reading of your word. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to gather and just to worship. Lord, we thank you that you care enough to teach us about your word and to give us a mission and to give us a vision and put in our hearts core values and purpose. And so, Lord, this morning as we expound on your word, I pray, God, that the anointing of the Holy Spirit would be on me as your messenger, and Father, would be on each and every one of us here today, God, that we would hear your word, and not only be hearers of the word, but that we would be doers of the word, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, this morning, I'm as I said a minute ago, I'm getting back into this series that we began, a few weeks ago before the holidays, and we've been examining the mission, the vision, the core values, and the purpose of Metro Grace Community Church. And so if you ever wonder who we are, who we're going to be as a church, that's what this message is about today. And this morning, we're going to be talking specifically about the values, the core values. You know, it's extremely important to us as a church, to the vitality and the life of this church body, for us to understand who we are as a church, who God called us to be, and where we're going in the future. We believe that we've had a mission that was given to us by God. We have a vision of what kind of church we want to be. We have core values that shape who we are and everything we do as a church. And you know, one thing about values, and I'm going to talk more and more about that through this morning, is that values are non-negotiable. Okay? Mission and vision can be altered as God leads, but values are things that are constant, that God puts in our heart. They're not something. These are the things that we believe so strongly in, so to speak, that we lay our life on the line for these values. And then we also have a purpose as a church, and we're going to address purpose next week. And understanding these things helps us to maintain focus. It helps us to stay in the proper direction in everything we do. So, and if you ever wonder why we make certain decisions or why we do things a certain way here at Metro Grace, then all you need to do is look to the mission, vision, values, and purpose statement, and you'll find out why, because you can find every decision we make rooted in one of these things, and specifically in these values that we're going to talk about this morning. Now, why would God give us these things? Well, several reasons. One is because God has a very definitive idea of what he wants Metro Grace to be. Do you believe that with me this morning? Yeah, he has a very definitive idea of what he wants us to be as a church. And he also gives us these things because, like I said earlier, it keeps us on track. Now, in the first two messages, we looked at mission and vision. This morning, we're going to examine our core values. And as we begin our study on core values this morning, we're going to examine three things. The first thing we're going to look at is the importance of having core values. We're going to look at what defines core values. What in the world is core value? And then we're going to look at what our core values are here at Metro Grace, the four core values that we build our ministry upon. Now let's begin first by looking at the importance of core values. Look at what the scripture says again in Luke chapter 12, verse 34. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now notice what Jesus is telling us here is the things that we value, we're going to invest in. Amen? You can look at your life and the things that are important to you, you invest in both with money and time and effort and all of these things. And so when Jesus said that, listen, he's telling the people, he's telling the church, he says, listen, you got to make sure you understand what your values are and that your values are in the proper priority, because wherever your values are, that's what you're going to invest in. And you might say, well, Brother Floyd, this is what I value, but then you look at your checkbook and it's something totally different. Jesus said, uh-uh. He said, where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. I heard Adrian Rogers once say, Adrian Rogers, one of the greatest preachers of all time, and he's passed on and gone to the Lord now. But I heard Adrian Rogers back years ago when he was still living and preaching at Bellevue Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee. I heard him say one time, he said, I can look at your checkbook and within 5 minutes I can tell you what the priorities in your life. And he said, I can tell you everything I need to know about your spiritual life by looking at your checkbook in 5 minutes. Why? Because where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We invest in the things that we hold dear. We invest in the things that are valuable to us, the things that we call our values. Now, the importance of core values. What is the importance of core values? Well, one, core values determine who and what we'll be as a church. Do you know that no two churches are alike? There's a lot of similarities between churches, but there are no two churches that are alike. Some churches focus on preaching, and some focus on Bible teaching, and some focus on evangelism, and some focus on counseling, and some focus on family, and some focus on all these different things. You know, that's one reason why it's necessary and it's acceptable to start new churches. You know, we've got a new church plant here in Pearl. It's a little older than this church, but it's affiliated with our same church planting network that we're involved with. And they're across the parking lot from one of our older existing churches. And you know what? Both of them are doing well. Why? Because no two churches are just alike. And so they're both filling the niche that God called them to fill. They're both reaching the people. How many of you know that not everybody's going to come to Metro Grace? And how many know there's people that come to Metro Grace that might not go anywhere else? And so that's why it's acceptable to start new churches, even when there may be churches right nearby, because different churches reach different people because there's no two churches alike. But what shapes us into who we are and who we're going to be in the future here at Metro Grace is our core values. And that's why core values are important. Here's another thing about core values. Core values dictate people's personal involvement in the church. Now, what in the world do I mean by that statement? Well, let me tell you something. I believe that we ought to be constantly communicating our values to anyone who considers becoming a part of the church. You know why? Because people have different values. Not everybody's values line up with the core values of Metro Grace. You know, not everybody that visits here is going to stay here. And that's not always a bad thing. You know, I had an old preacher tell me one time when I started out in ministry. He said, son, it takes some coming and some leaving and some staying to build a church. It takes all kinds. Not everybody who comes to Metro Grace is going to align with the vision and the mission and the values of who we are as a church. Not everybody likes the things we're doing. Believe it or not everybody is evangelistic minded. I mean, that's a testimony. When we have 80% of our churches are in decline right now, that's an obvious statement. And so not everybody likes that we're aggressively evangelistic. Not everybody likes that we're doing things different. You know, some people like things to stick to a tradition. Not everybody likes that we're open to whoever comes through the door, regardless of race or culture or nationality. And not everybody's comfortable with that, okay? But that's who we are at Metro Grace. And so we constantly communicate that. And if their values aren't aligned with our values, you know what? Then maybe they're encouraged to find a church where they match with their values. It's better for them. It's better for us. Now, does that mean I want to run anybody off? Heavens no. You know me better than that. I can't stand to see anybody leave. I think everybody ought to go to Metro Grace. But if we're going to be part of that core group, if we're going to be part of that team, then we've got to have our values aligned. There has to be a values alignment. And so core values dictate people's involvement in the church. Here's another thing core values do. Core values communicate what's important. When you look at our four core values, you know what's important to us here at Metro Grace. So we communicate those things. It keeps us, it makes it clear what we believe God's heart for the church is. Core values affect the church's overall behavior. Now, I talked about this just a moment. But values shape the entire church organization. They determine the direction of our ministries. They dictate every decision we make. They dictate every dollar we spend as a church. And so values affect the church's overall behavior. Here's another one that I like. Core values inspire people to action. You know, when we have shared beliefs, when we have shared conviction, it energizes people to take action. Values give us meaning. Strong core values touch people at a deep level that causes us, it brings significance to our life. It gives us a sense of cause, you know. It gives us something to get behind because we understand that we have something that's greater than us here at Metro Grace. It's not just about having church. It's about carrying out a mission from God that He's given us. And so core values inspire us to action. It brings significance to what we're doing here at Metro Grace and to our life. And here's the last one on the importance of core values. Core values contribute to ministry success. Do you know that understanding and embracing our core beliefs makes it possible for us to be successful in ministry? One of the things that I can absolutely guarantee you that no church, no ministry organization can succeed without having clearly defined, biblically inspired core values. Now, they may not write them down on a statement, but they are going to have some biblical values. They're going to have some God-given values if they're going to succeed. If they don't have clearly defined values, that tells me they don't know who they are as a church or what they want to be. They don't have anything to keep them on track. And you know what happens when we don't have things to keep us on track? We fail. It doesn't matter if you're a church or if you're a business, a secular business. You have to have clear goals and clear values of who you're going to be as a business. I'm going to borrow Bobby for a minute here. Bobby owns his own business. And what he does is he rebuilds these big truck transmissions. And I mean big ones, not little truck stuff. I'm talking about, you know, big truck transmission. And he's successful in what he does because one of his core values is he's going to do it right. Am I right, Bobby? When his customers know that Bobby values doing it right the first time, and so they trust him with their transmissions. They bring them to him. There's no question. They don't go around shopping around here and there and there and there. He's got customers that have been coming to him for years. They continue to bring them to him. Why? Because he has core values that dictate the way he does his business. We here as a church have core values that dictate what we do, and it helps us to succeed. Without values, you can't succeed in anything in life. What are core values? What defines core values? Again, our scripture says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Again, it's things we're putting value on. A conviction, a core value, are really the core convictions of the church. What is a conviction? A conviction is something that's a firmly held belief. Not just a firmly held belief, but it's a firmly held belief that produces an action within us. Okay. If I'm absolutely convinced that the roads are frozen over with ice, and I'm convicted of that, and I know for a fact, and I believe it in my heart that the roads were frozen over with ice yesterday, what action did it produce within me? I stayed at home. I stayed off the road. Okay? If I believe in my heart that it's going to rain, I'm going to do what? I'm going to take a raincoat or an umbrella with me. It produces an action. If I believe that Jesus Christ is the only hope for the world and that there is no hope outside of Him, then what's it going to do? It's going to produce an action in me. It's going to cause me to go to my lost friends and my lost neighbors and my lost loved ones and plead with them and beg with them and share the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ with them. Why? Because if I truly believe that, you know, I'm going to digress here a minute, Donatella. We profess in the church as Christians that we believe that those who are lost without Jesus Christ upon death enter into an eternity of a place called what? Do we believe that? Do we really believe that's true? Yet day in and day out, we let them continue on their way without so much as a fare thee well, so much as saying, hey, let me share the truth with you. Let me help you. If you walked by a drowning man sitting on, if you walked out on the pier and there's somebody drowning at the end, you'd at least throw up a life jacket, wouldn't you? Or if you didn't have a life jacket, you'd at least get on your cell phone and call 911. You wouldn't ignore their plight, would you? I hope you wouldn't. But yet we confess that we believe that the saved go to heaven and the lost go to hell. Yet we pass by every single day. and we won't even pick up the phone and call 911. Is it truly a conviction? A conviction is a firmly held belief that produces an action within us. Core values are those convictions. It's those things that we believe so strongly and we are willing to sacrifice for them or even give our life for them. You know, I watched a movie just a few weeks ago called End of the Spear. Anybody seen End of the Spear? If you haven't seen it, you need to watch it. Wonderful, wonderful movie. And in that movie, these missionaries were trying to reach this tribe in South America in the Amazon rainforest. And this tribe that they'd only heard about, nobody even knew for sure they were there. And this guy's flying around until he finally finds them. And these group of missionaries go in there, land on a sandbar in an airplane, try to open up communication with this tribe. And through lack of language skills, there was a miscommunication, and the tribal warriors panicked and killed all the missionaries. You know what the missionaries' wives did? They reached out to the tribe and moved in with them and taught them all the gospel. Rather than hating them, rather than asking the soldiers to go in there and wipe them out. Their conviction was so strong that those people needed Jesus. They were willing to make the ultimate sacrifice to reach them. Core values are the core convictions of the church. What do we believe strongly enough we're willing to sacrifice for? Core values are those things we're most passionate about. See, one thing about core values are they touch the heart. They ought to elicit strong emotions. They ought to stir feelings inside of us that move us to a biblical, Christ-honoring ministry, things to reach the lost that we're passionate about. Core values ought to stir a passion within us. Here's another thing about core values. Core values are constant. Now, you know, earlier I mentioned this briefly, but vision and mission, we've talked about the last 2 weeks, are fluid. There are some points of vision and mission that can be changed readily to meet the needs of the church and the needs of the community. If we sense that God is calling us to add something, we can amend the mission. If we feel like God's calling us in a different direction, we can amend the direction of the vision, of the mission. If we feel we begin to see God opening it up different doors for us, the vision can change. Those things can be changed readily. But core values are constant. If there is a change in values, it comes very slowly. Change in values usually takes a minimum of 2 to 4 years. If you're trying to change the values of the church body, it typically takes 2 to 4 years to get that the buy-in from the congregation to buy into the values that you're trying to teach and to honor within the church. You know, that's why it's so hard to revitalize our existing churches that are in decline. Because whether we like to admit it or not, there are certain values that have gotten ingrained within that congregation. And those values may not be God-honoring. We may value being a family church where everybody comes together, but it's us forward no more mentality. We close shop. We may value the fellowship that we have within in there, but we don't value evangelism and bringing new people in. You know, I've had conversations with churches and pastors, and I've had people tell me, yeah, I don't understand why folks don't want to come be a part of us. We're a friendly church. Man, we're so friendly. Well, you are friendly to each other and the people you know and the people you've known and grown up with for the last 30 years. But when a new person comes in, they're ignored or they're shunned because they're not part of your group. You know what that is? That's a value. They value their group. They value their family. And it may not be a stated value statement, but it is a value within the heart. And it takes 2 to 4 years minimum to change that. And so some of our churches that are struggling, that's why it's so hard to revitalize them. Now, why am I sharing all that with you in such details? Because it's critical. Everybody look at your neighbor and say it's critical. That we begin with it and stick with the right value. Because values are so difficult and take so long to change the direction within a church, it is absolutely critical. We have the opportunity as a fairly new church here to stamp this thing and guide it in the right direction from the very beginning. That's why it's critical that we embrace godly biblical values that will guide us into growth and doing the mission of God and we stick with them. Amen?
Amen.
Because if we don't, then we'll be no different than all the other churches out there that are struggling. Here's another thing about core values. Core values are biblical. A true test of your core values is this. Does it line up with Scripture? Does it line up with Scripture? Now, understand, it doesn't have to be found word for word in the Scripture. But our values should clearly reflect the principles and the precepts that are found in the Bible. They certainly should never contradict the Bible. Amen? Our values doesn't have to, we don't have to find them word for word, the value statement in the Bible, but they ought to clearly reflect the principles, the precepts, the core beliefs, the doctrines of the Bible. They ought to be biblical. And here's the last thing about core values. Core values ought to drive the ministry. They drive ministries. Again, I mentioned this briefly earlier. The decisions that are made ought to be what? They ought to be values driven. We ought to line them up and say, hey, how does this line up with our values? The money we spend, the risk that we take as a church. You know, everything we do as a new church is a risk some way or another. I like to call it an experiment, not a risk. We experiment with a whole lot of things. You know, I've told you before, we'll get a whole lot of them wrong too, won't we? Amen? That's okay. Because we're going to get a whole lot of it right too with God's help. Amen. We don't always know what to do. We know why we're doing it, but we don't always know exactly how to do it and what to do. But everything ought to be driven. Every problem solved, every goal set, every priority that we make in our life ought to do what? It ought to be driven by our core values. So we've seen so far, I believe we've established the importance of core values to a church. We've defined what a core value is. Now I want us this morning to look the meat of our message at what the four core values of Metro Grace Community Church are. So what are the four core values that we believe passionately about here at Metro Grace? And I believe passionately about these four things. I believe that everything we do ought to be driven by one of these four things here, one of these four core values. Here's core value number one. Every person is valued and loved by God. Therefore, every person is to be valued and loved by us. Say that with me. Let's all say it together. Every person is valued and loved by God. Therefore, every person is to be valued and loved by us. Now, that's a bold statement. That's a bold statement. Brother Ford, you mean I'm supposed to love everybody? Well, yeah, duh. Jesus did, didn't he? Even the ones that rejected him, he loved them. He loved them. Now, if you ever wonder if God is serious about this love thing and loving people, let me show you what he says in the Scriptures. Scripture says in John 3:16, probably the most famous passage in all the Scripture, says, "For God loved the world in this way, he gave his one and only Son so that everyone," say the word everyone with me, everyone. Does that mean he's leaving anybody out? No, that means everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Folks, if you never doubt that God loved the world, John 3:16 ought to solve that. The first part of our value statement says that every person is valued and loved by God. John 3:16 says, "For God loved the world this way." He gave the most precious thing he had. In Romans it says, hey, do we think God hold anything back from us when he already gave his son Jesus? So why would he withhold anything from us? So God loved the world so much that he gave the most precious thing. He didn't have to love us. You know, in the very beginning, after the creation of man, not long after creation, came the fall of man. And the Bible says that mankind sinned against God and separated ourselves in a relationship with God. God had every right to bring his full wrath upon us for sinning against him. We've all sinned. The Scripture says we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's not a one of us sitting here this morning that deserves the grace that we've received, but God loved us so much, he did what? He gave it to us anyway.
Amen.
He loved us. He loved us so much, he gave his own son. Now, if you still don't believe God's love, look at what it says in Romans 5 and 8. God didn't only tell us how much he loved us, he went out and proved it. You know, they say actions speak louder than words. Anybody ever heard that before? Actions speak louder than words. Romans 5 and 8 says, but God proved. That's action. His own love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Now understand, this is an unbelievable twist thing. It's not hard to be friends and to love somebody who loves you, is it? It's not. If somebody's doing you right, somebody's treating you kind, somebody's blessing you all the time, somebody's pouring good things into your life, they got you up on a pedestal and they treating you like a king or a queen, it's not hard to love that person, is it? But God proved his love for us while we were still sinners. In other words, he didn't wait for us to clean up our act. He didn't wait for us to get it right. He didn't wait for us to make the first move. He loved us while we were still sinners so much that Christ died for us. He made the first move. He made it possible for us to love God and to receive his love. So God showed us that he loved us. He told us that he loved us. And then he showed us that he loved us. Now I know some of you are thinking, well, that was easy for God. He's God, right? He's God. Hey, it's easy for him to do. He created everybody. He can love everybody. But let me tell you something. As a Christian, look at what Jesus taught us in John 13 and 34. I give you a new command. Love one another. And it didn't say just love one another. Look at what he says. Just as I have loved you, you must also love one another. How did Jesus love us? Unconditionally. Sacrificially. He gave his own life for us. That's how much he loved us. He made it possible for everyone, no matter how bad, no matter what they've done, no matter how grievous their sins may be, he loved them so much that he went to the cross, and even the ones that were tormenting him and mocking him and the ones that had crucified him, in his dying breath, he looks down from the cross and he says, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing, even the ones that had hurt him and harmed him so bad. Do you think people are important to God at this point? And if people are important to God, then guess what? They ought to be important to us. Jesus said, I give you a new command, love one another just as I have loved you. You must also love one another. John says it this way later on. He says, we love. Why? Because he first loved us. John says, this is why we can love. Because we've experienced the love of God. Now we're taking that same love of God and going out into the world and loving other people the way Christ loved us. In other words, what are we doing? We're living out the commandment that Jesus gave us to love as he loved. Every person is valued and loved by God. Therefore, every person is valued and loved by us. You know, there's a lot of people in this world that don't feel loved. Some of you here today may have felt that way. You may have felt yourself being that way. You may have felt like that you didn't have value, that you were worthless, that you were unlovable. You'd be surprised at how many people I minister to. When we go downtown on Sundays and other times and minister, many of the people that are caught in that homeless situation out there, those streets take over in their spirit and in their mind, and they get to the point where they see the truth. That you can even share the gospel with them, and they see the truth, but it's so hard for that gospel to get inside them. Why? Because they're convinced that they're unlovable and they're unworthy and they have no value. And then society treats them like they have no value. They're throwaway people. You know, that's a problem that we have in our society today. You know, we've got disposable diapers and we've got disposable this and disposable that. And, you know, fast foods and disposable wrappers and everything goes in the landfill. And we have people that are broken and bruised and hurting in their life. And their lives are broken and the enemy has just assailed them and beaten them down. And instead of lifting them up and loving and caring for them, we want to put them in the landfill of life. I want to tell you, God says to love those that he loves. And if we'll do that as a church, God will bless us. And we'll be able to reach those that are hurting so much in their life. Every person is valued and loved by God. Therefore, every person is to be valued and loved by us. Here's core value number two. I want you to say this with me. Every person deserves to hear the gospel and have an opportunity to respond by faith to God's offer of salvation. Let's say it together. Every person deserves to hear the gospel and have an opportunity to respond by faith to God's offer of salvation. Every person. Well, Brother Floyd, I don't know about old so-and-so. You don't know what kind of life he's lived. Well, yeah, you don't know what kind of life I lived either before Jesus came into my life. Amen?
Amen.
Some of us, we wouldn't want to be opening up our closets for everybody to see either. Thankfully, the Lord cleaned out those closets. But look, every person deserves to hear the gospel. Now, as a church, we've been given a command to take that gospel to them. Jesus said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You notice what it says, go. That word go is an action word. You can't go while you're sitting still, can you? You can't. Go means we have to put forth effort. It means we have to put energy into it and make disciples. Now, I want to tell you, I'm all about making disciples. We need to teach people. You're going to see in some of our other core values the importance of discipleship. But for right now, understand this. I can't make a disciple out of somebody who's not saved, can we? So the first part of making disciples is to do what? To lead them to the Lord. Evangelism, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to notice a couple things here. Go, therefore, make disciples out of, who does he say? Of all, everybody say that word, all?
All.
Nations. Now, understand something about this word, all nations. He's not talking about geographical boundaries and governmental entities the way we think of nations today. Now, should we go to Mexico or Ghana or Bangladesh or wherever with the gospel? Yeah, I understand that. But that's not what that means. That word, all nations, that word would easily be translated peoples. To all peoples. Not all people look like us, but all people. He said to go to all people anywhere. Not all people act like us. Not all people look like us. Not all people speak the same languages that we do. But the scripture says we're to do what? We don't leave anybody out. We're to go to all nations. In other words, all nationalities. All peoples. With the scripture. That's the command that he gave to the church. And so we believe in obeying God's command. We believe that every person deserves to hear the gospel. It doesn't matter what they've done. Now understand this. You and I can't force somebody to get saved. That's not our job. You know, one of the things that, and I probably am overthinking this song, okay? I'm probably overthinking the song, but some of you have heard me make this statement before. I think we've done a disservice to our people in our churches. Because for years and years, we used to tell people, you need to go out and be a soul winner for Jesus. You got to be a soul winner for Jesus. Well, let me let you in on a little secret. You can't win souls. The only person that can win souls is the Holy Spirit. You know what God called us to do? He said, be a witness. In other words, to tell what we know and what we've experienced. That's all a witness does. You can't win a soul anyway. See, so many people get caught up on, I got to be a soul winner for Jesus. And then when they realize they can't do it, and it's so over their heads, they quit, they don't do anything. Well, Jesus didn't ask you to do it. He told you to be a witness. You go out and you tell about what you know and what you've already experienced. And we do that. And we make disciples of those that hear the message. I can't make somebody accept the message, but I am going to be held responsible whether I shared it with them or not. Amen?
Amen.
Whether I tried to lead them. Now, I want to tell you how strongly God wants people to be saved. Look at what Peter said. Peter was talking about end times here in 2 Peter 3 and 9. And understand, there's going to come an end of all things. Christ is coming. He's going to return. He's going to set all things in order. And for the Christian, that's going to be a wonderful time. But for those who have not accepted Christ, it's going to be the worst day possible for them. But some people were questioning whether Jesus was going to return or not. And Peter says the Lord does not delay his promises. Some understand delay. But is patient with you. Not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. See, Christ wants people to come to repentance. What does that word repentance mean? It means turning away from the old life and turning to Christ. That's all repentance means. He wants people to be saved. He's done everything possible for people to be saved. And the church's responsibility now is to go and to share the gospel with all people and give them the opportunity to make the decision on whether to receive Christ or not. Now let me tell you how easy this gospel is that we preach. Look at what it says in Romans 10 and 9. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I love that. I love the simplicity of the gospel message. Look at what it says in verse 13, probably my favorite verse in all the Bible. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. You've heard me share this verse multiple times. Everyone. Nobody gets left out who calls on the name of the Lord to be saved. So we have the simplicity of the gospel, and if they'll confess with their mouth, if they'll believe in the heart that God raised them, Jesus from the dead, that they can be saved, and everyone who does this can receive the promise of God. So where does this tie in with our core value? Look at what it says in verse 14 of that same Romans 10. But how can they call on him they have not believed in? And how can they believe without hearing about him? And how can they hear without a preacher? Let me clarify one misconception right now. That word preacher doesn't mean a pulpit preacher or evangelist like me or Donatello. That's not what it's talking about. That word preacher means one who proclaims the message, one who shares the message. So you know what he's talking about? Anybody who is a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. So the gospel is simple. If they'll confess, if they believe, they can be saved, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord. But here's where the breakdown is. How can they call on him they have not believed in? How can they believe without hearing about him? And how can they hear without a preacher? In other words, everybody deserves to hear the gospel and have an opportunity to respond. And it's our duty as a church to make sure they hear it. It's their responsibility to receive it or reject it. But it's our responsibility to make sure they hear the life-giving gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe that passionately here. Somebody asked me one time when we were first getting started at Metro Grace, they said, what kind of church are y'all going to be? I said, evangelistic. And he said, I was telling them some of the things we were doing, and they said, that sounds a little hyper-evangelistic. I said, I like that term. I said, I don't apologize for it. I won't. Because people have to hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right around our area right here today, within 15-minute drive of Metro Grace, this location, the latest demographics we have at the best case scenario, 175,000 people that are unchurched, most of them lost. Some statistics we had showed as many as 220,000. Right here in our area, folks, we have a mission field that is ripe. As Jesus said, hey, the fields are white. They're ready to harvest. We've got to be faithful to share the gospel with everyone so that they can have the opportunity to hear. Here's a third core value. There it goes. Core value number three. Now notice we make a change. Value one and value two says every person. Core value three and core value four start off with every believer. There's a difference there, okay? And notice where the focus goes. Core value number three says every believer needs, everybody say needs. Not everybody wants it, but everybody needs it. A biblical moral compass to guide and protect them throughout their life. Why do we take so much time to teach and to preach? Why do we put so much effort into developing the sermons so that there's meat in the sermons? You know, it'd be a whole lot easier for me and Donatella and to get up here and, man, we could stir the crowd up. I mean, I've done some evangelistic preaching where the messages are a little bit shallower, you know, and you can get the folks to shout and all that because you don't have the opportunity to preach. But in pastoral preaching and teaching, there needs to be a depth there because we're feeding a congregation. our teaching? Why do we put so much effort into developing small groups? Why do we want to have at least 10 small groups going in next year? Why? Because we believe that people need to be growing up in the Word of God. Why? You need a biblical moral compass to guide and protect you throughout their life. That's what we need as a believer. Too many times our churches, even the ones who are doing a decent job of evangelism, are bringing new believers into the church, patting them on the back after they come up out of the baptismal waters, and sending them on their way. And we wonder why they're falling through the cracks and they're not thriving in the Christian life. It's because we're not giving them the biblical moral compass to guide and protect them throughout their life. Scripture says in 2 Timothy 3 and 14, speaking of the Word, it says, "But as for you, continue." Everybody say continue. This isn't something we start, stop, start, stop. We continue in what you have learned and firmly believed. You know those who taught you, and you know that from childhood you have known the sacred scriptures, which are able to give you wisdom for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. They're able to give you what? Wisdom. All scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete. Everybody say complete. We got too many people that's lacking. You know why? Because they hadn't got the Word out. We believe you need a biblical moral compass to guide you throughout your life, from cradle to grave. And so at Metro Grace, we're going to make sure you have the opportunity to be taught the Word of God. Now, you know the old saying, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. We're going to provide the opportunity, but you know what? You have to avail yourself to the opportunity. You have to take advantage of the opportunity that we're going to provide for you. You have to want it. Why is it important that we get this biblical moral compass? We study the Word of God. We know the Word of God. We apply it so that we may be complete. We got too many Christians that don't know what to do. When troubles come in their life, when they're tempted, when these moral decisions and things come up out in life, they don't know which way to stand. Why? Because they haven't allowed themselves to be made complete through the Word of God. We're going to give you the opportunity to learn the Word of God, but you've got to learn it. You've got to receive that opportunity. You've got to take advantage of that opportunity. You know what? Look at what it says in 1 Peter 2 and 2. This is the way we ought to be when it comes to learning the Word of God. Look at what it says. Like newborn infants, desire the pure spiritual milk so that you may grow by it for your salvation. Anybody ever seen a nursing child when they first start nursing and they just go after it? Little Benjamin. Y'all know little Benjamin, Sarah's little son, Benjamin. I was helping in the nursery on one Wednesday night. By the way, Benjamin just had his year birthday here recently, so he's a year old. A couple months ago, though, I've never seen a child that loved a bottle more than Benjamin. And when he got hungry, he let us know he was hungry. He's a very easy baby to keep, but when he gets hungry, he lets you know he's hungry. And so Carrie's trying to get a bottle fixed quick enough to suit him, and she wasn't getting it fixed quick enough to suit Benjamin. But when she handed me that bottle and I gave it to Benjamin, I thought he was going to collapse the sides of it. He was going after that bottle so hard. Folks, that's the way we ought to go after the Word of God. That's the way you, if there's a small group near you, you ought to be a part of it. You ought to be involved in it. You ought to be taking notes in here, listening in here. We record all these. We have them on our YouTube channel and our Facebook page. You can go back and watch these messages. You can take notes and learn and study and just apply all of these things that we're trying to give you. We're going to do everything we can as a church leadership to provide you with opportunities to grow. But like the newborn baby, like that baby, you got to desire it. You got to want it. You got to go after it the way he went after that bottle. I mean, so hard that I thought the sides were going to collapse in. So that you may grow by it. Have that biblical moral compass. We believe that that's important. And that's why we spend so much effort in preaching and teaching and giving the, even when we're preaching, we're trying to teach. So that you have that Word of God to build yourself by. Here's number four. Yep. It don't work when it's off. I turned it off somehow. Core value number four. I want you to say this one with me out loud. Every believer has unique gifts and talents to be developed and used to strengthen the church and for ministry. Notice what that says, every believer. So if you are a believer, if you are a saved person this morning, if you have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and I believe, and I'm going to show you from the scriptures in just a moment why we believe this, you have a unique gift, you have a unique talent that is to be developed and used to strengthen the church and for ministry. There are no unimportant members. Look at somebody next to you and say, you're important. You are. Everybody here has a place, and everybody here has a calling, and everybody here has a ministry that is uniquely given by God to be used as part of this body. Look at what it says in 1 Corinthians 12 and 4. Now there are different gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different ministries, but the same Lord. There are different activities, but the same God activates each gift in each person. The demonstration of the Spirit is given, and watch this, why is it given to each person? To produce what is beneficial. Now follow me a minute. That gift of the Spirit was given to each person, okay? Everybody wave that. Everybody that's waving, you're one of those each persons. The Holy Spirit gave you a gift, and He gave it to you for a reason, to produce what is beneficial for the whole. Understand that. Wasn't just for you, He gave you that gift. He gave you that gift. Why? To be developed, to be strengthened, and to be used for the church and for the ministries of the church that He's giving us. The Spirit gave each person something that produced. Now look at what it says in verse 12 of Corinthians 12 and 12. For as the body is one, understand, we're here, we're together, we're one body, but it has, what, many parts. All the parts of that body, though many, are one body. Again, He reminds us that although each one of us is absolutely different, there's no two of us alike. You know, even with identical twins, there's always some little something. I mean something. You might not can recognize it, but they can. And there's something. There's no two DNAs that's exactly alike. There's no two fingerprints that are exactly alike. There's no two noses that are exactly alike. I mean, and we all have something different about us. And that's a good thing. Too many times we let our differences separate us when God purposely put those differences in us. If we were all just alike, all of us but one wouldn't be needed. That's the truth. You ever heard the saying, opposites attract, for couples? There's a reason. Now look, you ought to have the same values. You ought to have similar goals. You ought to be on the same plane with your relationship with God. But my wife and I are extremely different on some things. Okay? She is very meticulous and organized, and I'm not. You know what? That wears on her. But she can be so meticulous and organized with certain things that it wears on me. Most of the time during life, that's a strength for her. But my strength is, in the middle of the crisis, when everybody else is falling apart, boom, it's like the world slows down for me. I have the ability to fly by the seat of my pants. Now, sometimes that's not good. Most of the time, it's not good. But in adjusting to change and adapting to things is a strong point that I have. Being able to cast vision and being able to inspire others to get on board with vision is a strong suit that God gave me. But sometimes implementing the organization of that, I need others in the team that help with that. You see where God puts us all in here together. He puts us there so that every person's weakness and every person's strengths mesh together so that collectively we're much stronger and better than we are individually. Amen? That's why opposites attract in a marriage. If you put two people that are wired exactly the same in the marriage together, then one of them's not needed. That's the reason God put you. Her strengths helping my weaknesses, my strengths helping her weaknesses, and together we are one. We are much stronger together than we are apart. The problem is too many couples look at their differences and say, you know what, I can't stand that you're different than me on this, and they get a divorce and they go their own separate way, rather than recognizing God wired you different for a reason. Amen?
Amen.
Church members fall out with one another and fall out of unity with one another because, you know what, I don't like your idea about this. Well, you know what, God put different ideas in the body together. We have to have common values and common vision. But it's okay to disagree. Because we're not all going to agree on the same thing. We're not all strong in the same areas. But God put us together so that together we're strong. I'm going to skip this. Look at what Romans 12 enforces. Let me go to that next one. Now, as we have many parts in one body, and all the parts do not have the same function, in the same way, we who are many are one body in Christ. Everybody say, one body. And individually, members of one another. We belong to each other. God put us together for a reason. We believe that you have gifts and talents, according to the Scripture, that need to be used here. So I want to encourage you to find your gift, find your talents, find your abilities that God has given you, and get busy using them within the church as God has called you to. As I close this morning, let me say this. I'm gonna close this. I believe passionately in what we're doing here at Metro Grace. I'm not going to apologize for being passionate about what we do. I also believe there's a need for other churches who embody the same mission, vision, core values, and purpose that we have here at Metro Grace. And as we close, I'm going to ask each and every one of you this question. Will you embrace the core values that God has given us for this church? Will you join in the work? We can't, we cannot accomplish the task God has given us without a dedicated team of leaders and volunteers who embrace these values, align with the values that we have, and join in the work. Every single one of you has a vital role in carrying out the work of God here in this church and in this community. There is a place for everyone to serve. You are important and you're needed. God's got a place for you. God's got a call on your life. Will you answer that call this morning? Some of you here this morning, you may not have known the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. I want to tell you this morning, as we read earlier, if you're willing to confess Him with your mouth as Savior, believe in the heart that God raised Him from the dead, that He is who He said He is, to turn away from your old life and turn to Christ by faith, the Bible says that He will save you. He won't turn anyone away who comes to Him with an honest and open heart, seeking Him.
This is Pastor Floyd Stevenson, founder and lead pastor of Metro Grace Community Church in Pearl, Mississippi. I would like to thank you for watching this week's broadcast from Metro Grace Community Church. We pray that this message has been a blessing to you. If you live in the Jackson, Mississippi metro area and are looking for a church home, I would like to invite you to join us for worship this coming Sunday. Worship times and location.